Hello, everybody. This is Alex, and I'm happy to welcome you again to another game of Babylon 5 CCG of the collectible card game. This is me and my friends in Košice in the Hravý Goblin game store, where we played this three-player game approximately a month ago. So I will not be able to recall all the intricacies, but I think I will give you quite a good commentary about what was going on, how we played it, and what was the situation on the table. I'm also to provide like little pictures of the card, individual cards that are being played now. If you need to read them, please just pause the video for a while, and that's it. So we have three players: Daniel with Jakarm, myself with Jeffrey Sinclair, and Lukáš with Bester. So. Okay, the first of all, we set up initiative, and Bester is beginning with Psychorp's intelligence. Now, this costs normally 6 influence to get into play, but as he is Bester and playing a Psychorp, it only costs him the half, so only 3, so he can allow to do that. He's allowed to do that. I'm building, and Jakar is getting Kodath in the game for 2 influence, so he has 2 left for the remainder of the turn. He also, out of initiative, as it is the first round, plays Conscription, where he loses 1 power and gets the first card loyal to his faction, which is Just Then. I am serious. I mean, how can he get Just Then at the first? Just the first card being Just Then. So, kind of wow. A strong character on the table. I display a contingency, and Bester got his ability of the Psychorp's intelligence, which means that he can look at the top four cards of his deck and place one of them at the bottom. So kind of card management. So, yeah, the next round begins. I'm at 5. The guys are at 4, so I will be the last one. And the Bester, the Psychorp's are building influence. I remember the last, so Jakar promotes Kodath to the inner circle, so he rotates and gets Kodath promoted. I get nowhere to hide into game for 5, which allows me to get another destiny mark on my ambassador. My deck is actually a destiny card deck, so I will have to have more of them than just the 2 I have now. And Jakar or Kodath tries to build, but he has only 2 influence left, so he, or 1 influence left actually, so he cannot do it, so he untaps, unrotates, and waits for what's going next. Okay, Psychorp's intelligence again, so he manages his deck and looks at the top 4 cards. One of them, yeah, may be put on the bottom, so he does that. Good. Next one. We draw cards. We ready cards at the first phase. And there is a first conflict on the table by Narn player. It's a trade pact. He can play it, of course, and I'm just commenting it that while being played, that it's kind of unwise to do it right now, because I mean, if you can build influence to 10, it is very unwise to play trade pack below that number, as it gives you the possibility to very easily reach 11. So Daniel actually got it back on his hand, and he's not initiating this conflict. We're kind of a good fork, so we allow that to happen. In this case, he uses Jakar to build influence. Yeah, and okay, Bester is also building to 6. And 3 left. So yeah, and I'm just explaining some basic stuff. And I'm getting Susan Ivanova for 4, so I have another character in play. Good. So far. Psychorp's intelligence, by the way, a really nice card which allows him to do this. Oh, not four, but only two cards. Okay. And he leaves both of them on top. So, okay, sorry, I misinterpreted it. So, yeah, the round is at the end. We draw cards for remaining influence two. And next round of play begins. I am at five. Yeah, the Narno is also at five, and Bester is at six. So I will be first to go. And I'm rotating to promote Susan to inner circle. Costs me five, 4+1 per character. And the non-character is, Jinnikar is building influence. Bester is sponsoring Talia Vintas into game, which is nice. Good old telepath. And Kordat is also building, so he's going for seven. Oh, yeah. Sorry. Another Psychor's intelligence in game, in play. So, just managing his deck. And I'm... Okay, I'm sponsoring a hidden agenda. Hidden agenda, I do it this way as I do not have enough influence to do anything else, and I just want to spare some actions for the... or some rotating of a character for the time when I reveal it. So I just sponsor it right now, and they just reveal it as an action. I don't have to rotate anybody left. Anybody else did that time. Okay, next round, and I am building influence with Susan. Going for six. Okay, Bester is also building. I'm sorry for the camera not being focused on the play mats. I will do something better and next time so I can have a good one. Okay, Jakar is also building influence. This is a kind of a solid game until the 10. Well, the hack and play will start afterwards. And I am, again, building influence to 7, 1 left for this turn. Okay, Narns are going for 9 already, so they are kind of fast heading to front. And I, for the one left, I'm meditating and drawing two cards, which is cool. More cards, the better. I mean, you have to have three meditations in a deck, to be honest, because it costs you only one influence to draw two cards. If you just draw one more card afterwards, it costs you three. So every meditation in deck is actually influence well spent. So one of the cards, one of the must cards, to be honest. Okay, this round ended, and we have a new round in play. Okay. Bester is promoting Talia, so she's now in a circle. I am going for 8 influence, so building with Susan. Okay, and Nance going for 10 influence now, so this is going to be nice. Conscriptions are quite a nice card to play at the beginning of your play, especially if you have it in your opening hand, to search for a card. If you want to be sure you get the right card, try a deck which is full of neutral characters, but only has one or two cards of your own faction. If you use conscription, you just get the precise card you want. I used this several times and it worked out really well, especially if you want a really strong card, like a big character or a location or something like that. And you don't have to pay for it, so it's really, really good. You pay with one power, so at the end you will have to reach more power than anybody else. But yeah, should be fine. We're now explaining the game, or just the aim of the game, to a friend of ours who just came in. So it's really great to actually find some new people who are willing to, you know, indulge into this old game and get some new friends. You know, maybe they will buy some decks and get starting with it. So what is going on? I'm going for 9, building influence again. Everybody's passing. Do I do anything else? I don't have anything, so should be fine. We are drawing cards, and as the non-player has a 10 influence, I think he will certainly get a conflict. Yeah, that's what he says. Conflict. It's a trade bag, I suppose. So now he... Oh, I do also put a conflict into game. So, cool. Okay, so the 7. Initiative, first blackmail. Going on, okay, against Susan, which is shit for me. But we'll see. I don't think I will have chance to actually defend this one, so this will be very bad for me, but who knows, we'll somehow manage. There's still a chance of I can demote her, so this is kind of okay. I'm playing Fate Calls. If successful, I get a Destiny mark, so another of the marks I need. And if I... Okay, a trade pact. That's what we have really seen. And it's going for with my faction. So this is kind of cool. I can get an easy boost. So, oh, the Psycorp's getting nobody can stop us. So from now on, they will collect points, tokens for every successfully mastered side conflict, and every 3 mastered side conflicts are 1+1 to power. So this is kind of cool for them. Also, all of the psycho characters get a strife mark, which is really good at when playing with a lot of assassins, or you know, attacking characters directly and stuff like that. So which is cool. So okay. I'm thinking hard what to do, because I'm losing Susan. I will probably demote her or something. And if I'm thinking of, oh, maybe the agenda would be handy now, so we'll see. I'm passing, okay. So first of all, Jakar is getting a Book of Jaquan, +2 diplomacy, +1 leadership, and a destiny mark, so which is kind of cool. The Bester faction, the Psychors, are getting Psychors intelligence, and looking at the 2 next cards coming and putting one of them to the bottom of the deck. And I'm sighing. Oh, great. This is not looking good. And I take too long. Okay, I reveal my agenda. It's a higher calling, and I get +1 power for each 2 destiny marks. And if a character of mine, I think, is ambassador is taking part into a conflict which can earn my faction a destiny mark, he gets a +2 to his abilities, which is kind of cool. So I'm doing it right now, because fate calls, you know, guys, fate calls. Okay, just 10 is supporting the trade pact. It's actually not 8, but 16, but we kind of... Okay, by the way, this game is full of mistakes, so if you spot any, keep calm, go on, no worries, okay? So, just 10 is getting not... Okay, Talia Winter supports the conflict, okay? And just 10 does not contribute 8 to the trade pact, but 16, because... they apply double diplomacy, my faction and as a target faction, and the faction of the initiator. So he should apply 16. Okay, I'm getting okay, there's a contingency under my high calling agenda as an action, and I should do something with, okay, I'm using Jeffrey and getting 8 to support fate calls, because it's 4+4 from the agenda. So, I'm I'm kind of unwilling to put Susan into this because Jakar is still there, and I fear that he will attack. He's also strife marks, and if I lose Susan this early in the game, he could attack her. There is she wouldn't be able to do anything against him. Just do, I think, one damage or something like that. But he would give her like 7 damage. That would be killing her for numerous rounds, and I really need that character in game. So I'm unwilling to actually get her into this. And the turn is still in the end. We resolve, and I demote Susan. So yeah. Okay, my fate calls is fine, but I only get one destiny mark, not 2 as I wanted. And yeah, it was targeting Susan. And trade pact gone through, and I get 1. Yeah, and now I realize I kind of totally messed up my game, because I just should not let Susan get demoted, because I because my contingency under Jeffrey Sinclair is "And So It Begins," which means that I have to have 9 influence, and everybody had to be above 10 or 10 or more to actually reveal it. And now I have 10, and I'm not probably gonna get 9 or something. So I totally bollocked my game. I could have, with "And So It Begins," I could have received 2 more destiny marks. I could have received Captain Sinclair and a follow-up, an update to Susan Ivanova, which I could have used later in the game. Actually, right now already, because she would have 2 marks. I mean, this is such a bad game for me. Oh my god. I am so pissed about this right now. This was terrible. I mean, seriously, this was really terrible. It just cost me like 2 more rounds in the game. Really bad. Okay, I have a trade pact. I'm playing a trade pact, and I'm targeting, as I already have a trade pact with with Daniel, I'm targeting Alfred Bester. And there's another trade pact. We are such a nice free trade galaxy. So, and he's targeting, of course, also the Cyclops. So, yeah, Talia. Now he has to get as soon as possible to 10 or 9, whatever. But he has kind of too little, so yeah. Oh man, this was bad. At least I could have at least built to 10 and then got 1, which would be 11. Now I have only 10. This is just fucked up. Okay, whatever. So yeah, Talia built to 8 or something. I can't read it. And now I'm still deliberating about this, because this is kind of totally a mistake of a newcomer, and I should not make this mistake at all. So, but yeah, I got too carried away with all of this, and I'm passing, so I don't want to do anything. And Justin is again supporting this. And by the way, I should have got another destiny mark, because if Jeffrey Sinclair was supporting the conflict, he would have 4 diplomacy by itself, he would have had 4 from higher calling, and I totally forgot about the +2 ability boost from nowhere to hide, which was there all along. So I'm like, this was such a bad game from me. And I think I forgot about nowhere to begin and the boost to his diplomacy like for several rounds. So seriously wrong. But yeah, bad, bad, bad. Okay, so what was going on? I'm still mad about this, I can see, and I don't want to do. And I'm just negotiating with Psycorps if he wants to support this conflict or not. I mean, seriously, he only has, I think Besser has only 1 diplomacy, so which would be like nothing. But still, it would be more, and I really have to most probably get Jeffrey to support the conflict, so, which is bad. But we'll see. Okay. Oh, Daniel is a pro. He's mixing this card so well in his hand. He flips him like chuck, 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 chuck. Like, I don't know how to do it. Okay, and I still don't know what to do. I still have some possibilities in my hand, but I don't know what there are because I can't see them. And I'm using, oh, trained windfall. I'm 7, so I get one more, so I don't really spend it anywhere else. Koda is sponsoring Kamak for 11, which is just so ugh. And he gets +1 of in his influence rating, so he has 12 now. So this is seriously bad. And another huge diplomacy character, which is crazy. Just Stan and Kamak just at the beginning of the game. This is devastating, actually. So, a nice deck by Daniel. Really well done. So... yeah, I want to do something, and I want to... But now he has Kamak out, and I don't want to get shut down by him. But I will have to do. I will have to do something. Will I support it? I could have supported with 6, at least. And then I could support it. Ah, but there's Jakar still in the game. Oh, no, this is not working out for me. Jakar has 5. Okay, I'm just doing it. We'll see. I'm supporting it with 4. Totally forgot about by +2 again. And of course, Kamak is gaming against with whatever that is, 9 or 8 or 7 or something. So, too much. Oh, and I get double, so I have 8 now. Yeah, now we remember. Okay, so I actually should have 4 plus 2, which is 6, double, 12. But now I totally forget about nowhere to hide, so I have only 8, which is not good. Yeah, Bester is going for 9 only. Ugh, this is very slow. Sad Psychors. Even if they get the point from Territ Pact, it will not really boost them at all. So, yeah, sadly. Now they're laughing about it, that this is not going to work out for the Psychors at all. So... but I'm still kind of really bummed about how I played this, because this was so bad. This was like really, really the worst. But watch and learn, children. That's not how to do it. Okay. Okay, another 7 against. So this is not good. Ugh. Yeah, pass from the... I'm probably not gonna do anything about it. I still could have maybe won this if I got Susan and remembered that I have this +2, which would be +4, but yeah, I get, yeah. I just ditch it. The conflict is failed. Yeah. 13 for non-player. Nice. 13. Wow. Good. And 10 influence for the Psychors. Another. This is a well built. I mean, you know, you see a well built deck if there are conflicts coming every round. I mean, the good about playing conflicts is actually that you have to rotate characters or fleets to get in. But at the same time, you have still time, maybe if you have enough characters in the inner circle, you still have time to actually build one character or build one fleet each round. And this is Tester Metal. And I'm not really playing this very often, because I think it reverses the effects of the... If it fails, the conflict reverses effects, but which I don't like really much, because if something happens, you get really sucked. It sucks, kind of. So... but it actually can cost me some influence, so I don't want this to actually be that successful. We'll see how it works out. And yeah. Oh, by the way, the Psychorps have a 1 on their agendas, and it means they got 1 from their side conflict. In this turn, Hide also initiated the Cyclops intelligence conflict, which allows him to look at the top cards of another species and place one of the cards they looked at the bottom of their deck. Okay, Elizabeth Lockley on the table, and she's sponsored by the ambassador, she gets promoted directly, so this is a good one, actually, for me. She also has a strife mark, which is kind of okay. The Psychos are playing. Who are you? This is a really mixed bag of a Psychos Vorlon deck. Kind of rarely seen. So the Vorlons have now 5 influence, which is the dice in the middle. Vorlon mark on Vesta. This is kind of... It's very rarely seen that the Psychos are playing Vorlons, so... Is it a fun deck though, I think? Because if you want to have a faction which nobody really can touch, it's the Psychorps. They have a huge lifespan because every card with a Psy of 10 or more just have 10 points of damage. So before it leaves the table. So this is amazing. And it also can bum into other factions. Okay, Narnade on the table. A basic card of the Narn deck. And there is pass from the Psychorps and from me, I think too. And the pass. No. They want to put more in. So another boost towards test and metal. The metal. Okay, be seeing you, which is a nice card as an aftermath. He's looking at the top 2 cards by winning the Psychor's intelligence. Or 3 cards, is it? No, now it's 4 cards. Okay, so it's that way. The 4... and I'm losing one. But I'm not losing because I'm playing Hidden Treasury. So yeah, I'm losing and I'm gaining again. So that's fine. Okay, so the Psychor Intelligence functions as follows. You can rotate it to either manipulate your own deck by looking at the top 2 cards and then putting one below if you want to. Or you can place it as a conflict and look at the top 4 cards of another player and then place one of them at the bottom of his deck. Okay. Another round. This is bad because I think the Narn are already at 14 or something like that, or 15 even. I'm not even sure. They're really close to winning, so I have to do something about this. Oh, now he remembers he has +1. So, oof, ouch. Okay, we decide what to do and what kind of conflicts to play. Actually, to be honest, my deck consisted of several characters who provide destiny marks by themselves already. In this case, for example, in case of Elizabeth Lockley, I got her in because she can be promoted easily, and also because the upgrade of her Captain Lockley has a destiny mark. So yeah, that's why I got And So It Begins, but I didn't use it this. Oh, there's a Psych attack as a conflict from the Psychorps, and it's aiming at somebody, at some character. Okay, Kamak. Means he has to rotate somebody with Psy of 5 or more, and as long as this character remains rotated, the other character remains rotated also. So if he wins this, and he will probably, if Talia keeps staying rotated, Kamak will not be able to join the game, so we'll see. And it's the only conflict on the table, so we'll see what the Nard player does. Galen, okay, another character with a Destiny mark, so I'm getting one. I think this is maybe a different Galen. There are two variants of the card. Okay, now he plays Nathoth, and he places her into the into this inner circle because he was thinking about replacing, but replacing doesn't work as sponsoring. You don't have to pay, and you don't have to rotate anybody, so you just replace. In this case, it says you may replace Kodath, which means that instead of replacing Kodath, he just plays her as another character, and has both of them as two non-ambassador assistants in the game, so which is also quite good. This is a nice combination for the Narn. Also, I love Kodath as she's so so cheap. She's the only ambassador who goes only two, and if you get a nice start with maybe rapid growth or airlock mishap or something like that, you easily can get to 5 and to 10 very quickly with Narn opening hand strategies. Okay, Earth is coming into game for the Psycorps. So I will not be able to actually play it. I don't even know if I have it in my deck. I suppose not, as I don't really need it. I place the card under Galen, as he has the possibility that you can stack cards under him, and then just when he does something like oppose or support conflict, I think, or attack, you can ditch the cards, and he gets +2 for every card which is under him. Okay, the round ended. Talia. Oh, he unrotates her, which is so bad. And now he mentions it to him. Oh, are you unrotating? Actually, I'm not. Okay. I want to keep Kamak rotated. So now Talia actually needs to be rotated all the time. So we'll see how this works. Okay. So I have 12 influence. I think the Psychos has 10. And the Narn have 14, so very close to winning. Okay, we'll see how this works out for all of us. Okay, now there's no conflicts this turn, I suppose. Drop your barriers and I get Elric out for 7. Another diplomacy character for me, which is kind of okay. Power politics out, but he has to rotate somebody and he does not, so yeah. A fault on Daniel's side, and I didn't see it. Whatever. Okay, Psychos Intelligence, so he's managing his deck. And what else is being done? Okay, I'm playing another card under Galen, so just to stack him up for the next action there will be. I'm rewatching what I put in. Ow, Nafar for 8. Another strong diplomacy character. This is a huge improvement on Daniel's side from the past, and he's really getting hang out of the game and doing it really wonderfully. I love this. He has a nice solid deck. Really, really good. Nice characters, strong ones. Enough influence very early in the game to do something. He can easily win power politics several times and he's fine, so yeah. Okay, I'm playing, what am I playing? Oh, I played something. Carpe Diem, and I didn't show you the card, sorry. I played Carpe Diem, which means I can get a card from the discard, and I got Trade Windfall just to get another influence. Okay, Talia still sustains, so And now he bitches about it and he kind of forgets the sustain. And then he unrotates her and frees Kamak. So, okay. Yeah. Okay. And Daniel is, is sighing that he wishes that it would be a four player game so he can do another trade pact. Okay. So Psycorps are playing the Psycorps intelligence conflict. Power politics conflict for 9 influence from the non. And I don't think I'm doing anything, so I just hope I will do something to actually get this, because this is already getting really, really bad for anybody. Okay. The Psycorps, I think, pass. Okay. Yeah, he passes. So he doesn't do anything. Okay, I'm passing too because we don't there's nothing really going on. And then Justin is supporting, of course, power politics in the name of the non. 8 for the non, so let's see how this works out. 8. Ouch. That's crazy. Okay, I'm playing Living Legends, which gets a boost to my characters. Every character with a destiny mark gets +3. Every character with 2 or more destiny marks gets +5 to their abilities. So this is a good start. Okay, another, I think, 7 or 6. And Bester comes with, what about we agree on something? You support me. And how much do you have? And I'm telling him, like, I don't even know how much I do have, but all I want to do is just to kill those characters right now because I want to get rid of them. And Daniel is like, nothing will leave this table, of course. This is gonna stay. So, yeah. But he put 2 big characters into it already, and they are both in the supporting row, so this is a good chance for me to actually get them killed, both of them. And by them actually kind of getting his table cleared out, and he will only have Jakar and Kamak in the game. So yeah, we'll see. If I could at the same time win the conflict, I could get 2 influence, which is amazing. The week is so cool. Yeah. The strife marks are getting +2 in their, giving the characters +2 in attacks or if being attacked, so they just deal +2 damage. And now Lukasz asks whether he can attack somebody with the Psy ability, with telepathic skills. But the thing is, even if he would assign level the playing field on any teep, on any telepath, the character would need to attack another character with the ability that the previous character entered the conflict in. Okay, I'm getting right makes right, and I inflict extra damage in the number of my destiny marks, so +4 damage to every character who attacks, which is a devastating. Whoa! Oh, this is a nice one. So this is a good combo. It boosts my abilities, boosting my abilities by Living Legends, and then playing Right Makes Right, which makes every nice character with +2, like, nice amount of damage. So, okay, he gets Carpe Diem, and he gets Conscription, yeah. He wants to conscript another character or somebody, so. Which would cost him another power, but if he gets a nice character, this is a good one. Okay, I am rotating Jeffrey. and attacking just 10. So 4 plus, yeah, too many. And I get 8 damage in a turn, which means 4 plus 5, 8, yeah. I will get 1 severe damage afterwards, or something like that. Okay, so far. I am still not neutralized, as I have 4 plus 5, 9, so I still have 1 diplomacy left on Jeffrey Sinclair. But this will actually be over. My Jeffrey will turn around after the end of the turn, because then the effect of Living Legends will disappear, and he will only have 4. So then he will receive 4 severe damage on being neutralized. And actually, this should not be. Oh well, we'll see. This actually, I don't think he actually should get neutralized, because if okay, we'll postpone this discussion when this happens. But right now, we'll see what's up. Okay, what is going on? Now he kind of bitches about that he already like gone through the half of the or the four or the quarter of the deck, and the only card which provides him with any Volon marks was actually who are you? Okay, so another Nafar is out of the table after being attacked by Elizabeth Lockley. And conscription is being played. He doesn't have to actually show the cards, but he did so. So a Narn 8 is being played. Oh, this is such a bad call. A small character, ugh, with conscription. This is not nice. Sad Jakar. So yeah, that's not nice. Ugh, I think he hoped for more. So yeah. Minus one. Power for a character with 2 diplomacy is kind of a bummer. Okay, my the bad thing about this is that Elizabeth Lockley will heal for like too many rounds, at least for 3 rounds at least. Okay, we have another character in this, and this is Drop your barriers on Bester. And I really want to. Oh, he put Jakar and Kodad into this, didn't he? Oh, nice. So he will have 16, I suppose, right now on the table, if I see correctly. And I am. Putting Galen in for 12. Because it's 3 diplomacy of Galen, plus 3 through Living Legends, and plus 6 from the cards I ditched. I think there was some kind of fleets. So as nobody's playing fleets, I kind of ditched those. And popular support on Jakar, and he gets plus 2 diplomacy and plus 1 for the marks, plus 3. Which is a nice one. It's a good one. And so, I mean, I do have plus two power now, and I'm placing it on the board so everybody can see it. Through the higher calling, which gives me plus 2 for every 2 plus 1 to power for every 2 destiny marks. So just to be able to see that. And I'm sighing again. This is so bad. It could have been so much better. Ugh. Oh well. Come on, I need to win this. Do something. And I am playing again. Living Legends! Another 3-4 to my characters and getting some boosts. So, plus another 3 for Galen, so I have 15 right now. I should be 15. I'm 15. And I forgot to do that too. I mean, seriously. What am I? I'm hating myself now. This is crazy. I'm so slacking. Ugh. Okay, and now I'm also turning around and putting 1 plus 3 plus 3 plus 7 for my little Susan Ivanova. Herman Gray suddenly arrives, but he has no diplomacy, so this is kind of okay-ish right now. And he is... Oh, he's supporting the side conflict. So at least he can claim another token for his agenda. Okay. And I think actually I won this conflict. The power of politics, which is quite good. So, the exercises of the mind as a sign participant aftermath, which gives him +2. So this is a nice one for the future. For Harriman. He also looks at... Narn cards through Cyclops intelligence, and I am getting +2 from power politics, and now I'm losing. I only have 4, but I should have 6 actually, to be honest. So I should have only I should have only 2 severe damage because I totally forgot about nowhere to begin and nowhere to hide. As it is laying there on my factional cards. But to be honest, I'm not sure whether Jeffrey Sinclair should have been actually neutralized, because you have to be neutralized. You have to neutralize your card only after you receive damage. And I already received the damage at the point earlier in the game. So I should have stayed on like normally. But with 0, I mean, if your character's abilities drop to 0, it does not guarantee him being neutralized. He has to be dealt at least 1 point of damage to do that, which now actually was already over, so I should not have done that, but, well, it did, somehow. So, I don't think that this was well played by me either, so we'll see. But it doesn't really matter, because if all inner circle characters heal in the same turn, they just rotate to support the ambassador in healing. The ambassador is healed at the end of the turn, so this is kind of okay. I will get him ready. I will have him ready by the next turn, so this is fine. Okay, we are thinking about... Okay, there's a new conflict from the Narn. Diplomatic intrusion. Against me, so it blanks my agenda. By the way, this is a great, great card. Even if you do not win this conflict, the agenda is blanked the turn you play it. So if somebody's almost winning or winning at this precise moment in the game, you can delay it for at least one turn by blanking an agenda if the agent provides him with enough influence to win or power to win the game. Okay. Alfred Bester supports and promotes Harriman to inner circle. I'm healing Elizabeth Lockley and getting one less severe damage. And the Narn are playing Train Windfall and getting their lost power back through conscription. Contact with Wallons from for the Psycorps faction, and I'm healing Jeffrey Sinclair, which was not, which just shouldn't have been done, but whatever. As he shouldn't have been neutralized, but well, well, well. And yeah, Jakar supports diplomatic intrusion, so my agenda will, I suppose, will be, will be blocked for several rounds. Okay, Psycho's intelligence is being played, and he manages his card, which kind of comes up. Trade windfall from me, so another influence. I'm not now at 15, so this is actually quite okay. And I still have plus 2, so I have 17. I only need 3 more. If I could somehow get those. But if this diplomatic intrusion will go through, I will... Ah, another trade windfall. This is good. Thank you. Cards. By the way, it's kind of risky to play trade windfalls and to play it, hidden treasury, as there is Durin and Afil. If you have Durin and Afil, or if somebody has Durin and Afil and plays it, plays her, discards in your discard pile will cost you a lot of money, so a lot of influence. So do not be very kind of be strict with those. Only play them if you know nobody has Durin and Afil because they do not have Crusade, or if you can kind of get rid of your discard pile by playing some cards. So if you do that, that's fine. But you should be kind of warned. So it's an easy game, it's a cheesy way to get some points, especially as trade pact is such a favorite conflict. But I would be kind of worried about whether this is a good chance of actually, you know, getting stuff done. So stick with your solid conflicts and with your abilities, to be honest. So okay. Daniel laughs because he has Day of the Dead, and there are two nice big characters in his discard pile, which he can salvage and get into game at least for one round. Okay, the Psycorps have zero influence to spend, so they do not know anything. What do I do? Nada, I suppose. Do I do something? I have still 3 influence left. For the good of all, at least something. I get plus 2 influence for every Destiny mug I have. So I have 1, 2, 3, 4, times 2, 8. So I get a plus 8 for the next round. Just so I remember. Okay, Narn passes. And Psycorps, did I do something? Ugh, yay. This is bad for me because this diplomatic intrusion kind of blocks my progress, and I will not be able to actually get more. And it was the only conflict on the table, so yeah, my agenda is blocked or blanked for 2 more turns. I place it as an aftermath to it and put 2, yeah, 2 tokens on it, so yeah, 2 rounds. Jeffrey is healed at the end of the turn, which is cool. At least something. Okay, and I place the 8 to temporary, so I have 16 plus 8, 24. 25, is it? Okay. Yeah, 24, yeah. The question from Daniel is whether if there is no Centauri player on the in the game, if there is still tensions between the Narn and the Centauri, and yes, there is. So he can play Revenge and just gain plus 4 power because this cheesy racial agenda the Narn have. And Rise of the Republic, which the Centauri have. So this is kind of
ugh
for everybody else, but good for those two. Cheesy bad stuff. Okay, a conflict from the non and conflict from myself. Is there a conflict? No, no conflict from the Psychor. So, yeah, me first, and I do play Affirmation of Power, which is if I am successful, I get plus one. If I'm 10 and more, I get plus two. If I'm not successful, I lose one. And there is campaign for support. Any player may be supported, and okay, this is a kind of a not really interesting. I mean, it's not really interesting for me or anybody else because it just gives you an additional temporary influence to be used next turn. So, and it only can be a thing used for sponsoring characters. So, okay, if you want to populate your supporting row really fast, you can do it. But otherwise, I would not probably lose one round to just get additional influence. You can use some other cards to actually get that. So, sorry. I'm healing Elizabeth Lockley and he's trade windfalling. Great. Another plus one. Okay, he's minus two, so this is kind of almost. Ah, not meant to be on the trade windfall. But he has to pay seven, so which is kind of expensive, but he does it. So minus one, which is kind of good, I suppose. Galen gets another booster card. And another trade windfall. Oh my god. This is just the worst. Ugh. This is really bad. Three trade windfalls and the desk card just ran after each other. Ugh. Okay, Kosh Naranig is in the game. Wow. At least this will be easy for the Psychor's character to characters to get some Wall on marks, which is kind of cool. If he wants to play some stronger Wall on cards, which require them, he will have to purge them at the end of the round. But still, he will be able to play some cards which otherwise would not be able to get into game. And I'm sighing again. I'm really, really stressed by this game. It doesn't really work out for me. So, yeah. Okay, he gets... Okay, at least it gives me plus one, if nothing else. Okay, plus eight for campaign for support. With Jakar. Or was it Kamak? I can't remember. Oh no, Kamak is still yeah, wow. And plus two for campaigns for support through the AIDS work. So this is kind of cool. Campaigning for support, Jakar and the non diplomatic corps. Which is kind of cool because they really get, if nobody goes against, he will receive like 12. Oh wow, another plus whatever. So he will receive a lot of I think 15 or something like that influence to be spent next turn. So this is actually cool for him if nobody opposes. Alric turns and he. Oh, and he attacks one of the aides. And receives two damage. So minus two on the campaign. And Kodat another plus one or two, I suppose. Yeah. We're now discussing when the turns end. Yeah. The action round ends when everybody passes. Oh no. Bastard just entered the conflict with one diplomacy against or for Bester. And of course he has a contingency under him, so it's one for now, but it will be much more later on. Okay, another I get What did I do that?
Oh,
I attacked again. Okay. I attacked and then another non-8 just got neutralized. So this is kind of coolish. I got +1 through affirmation of support. And okay, cool. The best of steel skills, and he uses his psi ability against and not his diplomacy. So it means 15 against or 16 against 15. So this is kind of cool. And I used personal growth on Jeffrey Sinclair, so I can search my deck and get one card, which is an update of Sinclair onto my hand, which I should have had on my hand already, like since the mid of the game, because I should have played as it begins, but I did not because I'm a moron. So yeah, very bad, very very bad. Oh, now I'm totally now I'm totally mixed up what I did. What did I place? Why did I? Because I misplaced the card. Okay. Okay. One more turn for my higher calling to be blocked. I'm drawing cards. The Psy Corps don't have any conflicts. They should actually play a conflict, at least from... To be honest, if you have Nobody Can Stop Us as an agenda, you have to play a conflict every round. I mean, this is a prerequisite, and the Psy Corps intelligence is an additional conflict. So you could play actually two conflicts per round, which is the idea behind this agenda. So as you would generate two tokens per round, you would receive two power in three rounds, which is kind of okay-ish, I would say. It doesn't really give you much, but with further gains of other different cards, you would actually receive enough power to win, even with a Psychor's deck, even with the starter deck. I mean, it's kind of possible. So it's not easy, but it's kind of possible. And he does both of them, do they? Does he? Yeah, I think so. He does. Yeah. He plays one from the hand and one, which is Psychor's intelligence. So we'll see what happens. Okay. This is already kind of an end game because I have 17. I think very similarly, the non-player has also 18 or 17, but -2. And this is mind games on the game on the play field, which means that he has to get +1 at least from. Okay, and he's looking for my cards in my cards with intelligence. So, and I'm kind of happy now because I think I can actually get to 20, but I'm not sure how yet. Okay, he will purchase one. Or? Will he purchase more? Oh no, his first action is something else. Because further gains actually do need to be played as a first action. By the way, if you have on your card plays your first action, it really means the first action of a round, of the action round. Even if you would play in a conflict later in the round, e.g. through, let's say, John Sheridan, or if you would do it through there's an event card which allows you to rotate somebody with intrigue and just play an event, a conflict. So it would not be possible to play it if that would be the first action. Even if it would be the first action, you would not be able to play further gains late, because the contingency stipulates you have to play it as a first action of the round. Okay, now Lita Alexander is it's actually Lita empowered. So she needed some Warlord marks. That's why he actually I think bought them from Kosh. And now I actually discarded my agenda just to get rid of it. Just to get rid of the aftermath too. Because I maybe have one on my hand or maybe not. He has 16, so 18 minus 2. And I have 17. I'm really fucked. And there is power politics in the game. So he had 16 plus 2, 18. If he would then, actually, if he would just replace this agenda, the conflict of power politics would still stay in the game, because the conflict is separated. After it was declared, it's separated from the origin card. So even if he replaced power politics with revenge, which you could do, the conflict from power politics would still go on and would be resolved at the end of the turn. So this would provide him with plus 2 from power politics and plus 4 from the agenda. So he would win. 16 plus 4, 20 plus 2 minus 2 would be 20. That would be okay. Yeah. So, what will happen? I really need to. I'm already seeing this, so I really need to stop him. And there is a card coming for that matter. But it will also stop me, so. And I really need to do it right now, because if he switches the agenda this moment, it will be my end. I need to play a card which would stop him right now, but I know that this will also hamper me for the next couple of rounds, because if I play an agenda afterwards, it would also be hampered. And I have to do it. It's not a nice game for me. Come on. You know. Why is it so expensive? Me exclamating about this. Oh, and I have 17 influence. Come on, I can get anything going on. Come on, get it done. Get on with it. I'm counting influence. If I get this right, and I'm thinking like, no, I can't do it. I will not be able to do it. I have two characters who are already butchered, so minus two for Elric, minus two for Galen. This is not nice. The Nun will be winning, most probably. They're now discussing the... Oh, gosh, I'm so dumb. I'm so dumb already. Oh, another mistake by the non-player. He should have already got the agenda changed, to be honest. Okay, and drop the barriers. Drop your barriers on Harriman, which would give him a plus 4. Sigh. I can help you, tells me Daniel. And I'm like, you can't help me. And he's like, no, I can't help you. I don't think so. This is a fucked up situation. And I'm sighing again. I was really, really bad at this. I'm helping you. He's helping everybody. I mean, seriously. You're helping to fail me, probably. And it's so bad. Okay, come on. Go, go, go. Alex. And I did not... It's true. I didn't receive the cards I needed. I don't know where my... I received some... They didn't receive any characters which I have stocked my deck with, so I'm kind of bummed about this. We are just talking about Crusade and... come on, and I have only... No. Yes. What am I doing? This is such a bad game. Okay, I'm getting Elric to inner circle. And he's passing, another bad move. He should have changed the agenda. Okay, and I'm Elric. No, I'm not healing. This should have come like way earlier. But I wanted to, maybe I just wanted another, I don't know. This didn't really help me at all. I mean, I promoted another character, which is okay, but this was a huge risk from my side. Factional inertia is really good when you want to hamper somebody, and that means right now it's actually hampering everybody. So I don't have an agenda in play. There is the non-player doesn't have an agenda which gives him power. So directly as a boost. So this is actually not good. And I'm happy, but this was a bad butchered game for me, to be honest. This was from me and from Daniel. He should have already gotten to revenge earlier when there was chance of winning this in this game, during this play. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Mind games being supported by Harriman or somebody. Okay, I'm healing Elizabeth Lockley. Which is cool because I will have her there the next round. Daniel passes and he should have, even now, he should have gotten revenge into the game because it would give him at least plus one next turn. And I do not have anybody to rotate. So if I would go for higher calling, this would also not allow me to be able to grow as fast as he would be able to grow. In the factional inertia, which I played, is a card which, if you have an agenda, if an agenda enters play after this card being played, it the bonus it provides you with to power grows slowly over time. So every turn it's plus one. So the next turn it's plus one. The other turn it's plus two. Next turn it's plus three. So you have enough time to actually. It doesn't give him a full boost of plus four. At the moment when he plays it, but slowly, gradually rises. Okay. Oh, he didn't support Psychro's intelligence, but he got one from further gains and plus one for his token. And plus one through mind games. Which was okay, but right now I suppose he should have already have enough characters on his board, which would be enough to actually hold this for 60, because we are already far ahead in the game, and the Psychros are kind of underdeveloped, I suppose. Maybe the deck is too big, or maybe he kind of did not manage it well, but still, maybe there are not enough characters in the deck which are stronger Psychros characters. Because he should have gone 60 and she should have the mind games returned to his hand. So, yeah. Okay, Daniel decided to keep power politics as an agenda to be able to maybe get plus two for the next turn, which is okay, I suppose. It would give him another chance of boosting his play, but he should have already won this turn, to be honest. He should have played as well. He should have won. I don't know why he's happy. He shouldn't be. Bad game, Daniel. I mean, I did worse mistakes, so I don't have a word to say here. Okay, looking for new conflicts this turn. Okay, I'm playing one. Okay, I have 17 influence. Daniel doesn't have any conflicts, and the Psychros are playing Psychros Intelligence. Good. What kind of conflict do I play? Aggressive action. diplomacy may be used. It's an intrigue slash diplomacy conflict, and I am targeting another faction, and of course it's going against Daniel, I think. And if I win, I can decide whether I kind of get one influence or whether he loses one influence. Of course, I would be probably going for plus one, just to be sure. So, yeah. Okay, this is already kind of dragging, to be honest. And there's still... Oh my god, there's still like... even half an hour of play ahead of us. So this is gonna be quite... either dragging or kind of really, really dramatic. Okay. So... now we're counting. There is enough characters on the board already. And some of them are butchered, and some of them are okay, and yeah. Okay, I'm on, it's my turn, so I do place higher calling into game. It was the same as before, and I get receive plus two destiny marks, so yeah. I don't know why I actually thrown away higher calling before, because I didn't do anything good with it, so don't know what my idea was there. Yes, this switch should have come last turn. Ugh. Okay, this is it gives him plus four. Normally it would give him plus four influence or power, but in this turn gives him only plus one or plus zero or whatever due to inertia in play. And I think we did make some kind of a mistake here, because I think I kind of got the feeling that he put the agenda into play after around after mine, so I think we kind of miscalculated the end power. But it was, I mean, it was also Daniel's fault that he didn't kind of... Okay, I'm switching to Captain Sinclair, which is cool. He's a good protection against opposing conflicts against your faction, which is kind of cool. Okay, Harriman sponsoring the auxiliary. I think it's the auxiliary. I can't really read the card well, but I hope so. Galen is being boosted by some cards being placed under him, and I really like, I mean, Galen is one of these cards which are neutral, can be used in any conflict, he's huge on intrigue, good in diplomacy, and this card boosting thing is such an OP, I mean seriously, overpowered. It gives him plus two, and there is no limit to it. If there would be like a limit to him, as it was with Miyagi, or as it was with Trent, I mean, Trent being played that you have to rotate and stipulate the number of influence you are using, so it's kind of a one-trick thing. But still, this is a bit of a... I mean, it's kind of gross. So I suppose that's the minus to it. You can't even really use it every turn or something. But also plus two every turn is kind of good. So yeah. Okay, Psychos passes. Okay, eight against. Eight against, and there was already somebody else in it. So I suppose, yeah. Jakar with seven, so it's minus 15. Galen again, four. Supports the conflict, so it's three plus two, seven, I suppose. 7 plus 7, 8, 9, 16, is it? 16 against 15, so I have another 4 with Elric, and a 3 with, and just, no, nothing, plus nothing, yeah. Okay, I have 6 more on the table. 9, 8, plus 2,
So it's, yeah, not looking good for me.
Oh, I did such a bad thing. I should have used Galen's intrigue actually to put into this conflict. That's why I was like, really, ugh. It would be another plus two. So yeah, I'm putting Elizabeth into the game. Day of the Dead. It's a unique card, which means it can be only played once per game. And it allows him and everybody, I think, else to just go through there. Discard piles and get somebody into game for one round. Same terms. In this term, it's just 10. Yeah. Oh, and now we're talking that the episode Day of the Dead was written by Neil Gaiman. That's one of the prolific writers. Yeah, I do not think I will be able to actually get this aggressive action to go on. Because, I mean, this would be so cool because it would return into my hand and I could use it again and again and again. But, yeah, I 8 against it. Too much. I don't think I will make it. This is quite a lot, yeah. Even though just 10 is there just for one moment, but... This is a good Day of the Dead, good choice. And at the same time, it was a smart choice because nobody else had any characters in their discard piles. So, yeah, good choice for a card. Yeah, I decided that I'm not gonna support it at all because it's not worth it, and I don't think I am getting a prophecy, another destiny mark, just for the sake of it, just for the sake of the destiny mark, and a doom mark. Great, great. Early warning, okay. Opposition at a target in tree conflict of Warlord's influence, which is under 7 or 8, I think. Brilliant. But I mean, it wasn't really necessary because I was not really into playing anymore with aggressive action. But now Lucas wants to just get rid of his cards right now. He's seeing that he cannot win. He's around, what is this, 14 or something? Yeah. It's a lost one, so if nobody plays any, and he searches, he looks through 4 of my cards. Maybe he did put some nice cards. Maybe he did put some of my nicer cards at the bottom. So, if he... Oh, there is a trade pack, so maybe... We still don't have one with the Psychor, so... I still don't have one with the Psychor, so... And now we're discussing how much the revenge should be. And I'm thinking, like, it should give you, like, 1. With the next ready round. It is factional inertia, so... But I think we just miscalculated, because he already should have 1, and then by each ready round it should be plus 1 or something. So I think he's minus... I kind of robbed him of 1. I'm sorry. Okay, drawing some cards. And deciding... get ready. Yeah, resetting our influence. Plus 2 for my... For my higher calling, getting readied, and what else? Looking for a conflict. So, do we have some? Okay, I have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 destiny marks on the table. I would need at least. I mean, this would actually be okay because I have 17 plus 2. If I can get plus 1 destiny mark, I mean, this is already, I'm at 19 now. So either I win a conflict this turn and I get 18 plus 2, which it would be 20, through the agenda. And I don't know how much Daniel has, but he's also very near winning. Maybe he has like 16. He has 19. He has 19 minus 2, I think, 17. And he has plus 1. Which he should have at least. He should have 2, I think. Maybe he should have 1 now. I'm not sure, though. Maybe next turn. Okay. The good thing about this game is that the turns at the beginning are really quick. The turns at the end are really long. I mean, if not, I don't know if it's good for the card game, but at least it's funny. You have a lot of options. So, trade pact with the Psychorps. So it would give me plus 1. Oh no, a cheesy one. Rally the people. And he has the Destiny Mark to initiate, so this is cool. Oh my god, and this would be great. You are not ready would be so cool against this. But I don't think he has any. Ugh. He doesn't have anything. Oh my god, this is bad. Rally the People is a great cheesy conflict, the diplomacy conflict, because it provides you, if successful, plus 1, and for each 10 you win it, another plus 1 for your cards. The only thing is that he doesn't have so many great cards in the game, because I butchered all of them. So he has Jakar and he has Kamak, and if I would be able to actually destroy or kill Kamak, I would be actually able to kind of rob him of minus 1, so this also could be quite good. We'll see. Okay, I'm turning Elizabeth. No, I'm not. Okay, I'm rotating Jeffrey. And I'm supporting, just to be sure that there is something. For 7 plus 2 from nowhere to hide, 9. Now I actually remembered to use this card. And Kamak is supporting with 8. Brilliant. Or 9, whatever. A lot of. Yeah. For every 15, I'm sorry. Yeah, now we are looking at the card text. It actually, he needs to actually 15 for getting another plus 1. But, yeah. If he would have all of his huge diplomatic forces, he could easily amass 3 influence from this agenda. The good thing about this agenda is that it's restricted to only your characters. So Garibaldi in the game and another Destiny Mark. This is so cool, and I love this. This is a great card. This is a great card actually, because it allows you to actually also search for upgrades. So I could actually search for Susan's Ivanova upgrade, but she only has one Destiny Mark, and I would not be able to upgrade her, to replace her. Or I could, well, that he came too late, but whatever. Okay, he gets 2. What is he doing? What's going on? He kind of reversed everything he did. Okay, and I played. Where did I get that? What did I play? Did I rotate somebody? Oh, and I remembered that I'm getting double, so I have 18. Okay, sorry. I was like, what was going on? And I replaced Lockley with Captain Lockley. She has a Destiny Mark, so another Destiny Mark. I have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 Destiny Marks now, so it would give me plus 3 at least next turn. And now he has leveled the playing field and wants to go against leveled the playing field on Letha. Lita, and I mean, she has, I think, 16 or whatever diplomacy, so this is a huge character to actually allow him to go against it. Okay. Coolio. Well played. Well played. I have still 18, so I'm fine. I'm gonna get a plus one. And the Kamak was supporting the conflict, so I'm thinking of maybe killing him, but with whom? I think the CEO would be quite okay. He has a strife mark. Maybe he gets killed, but at least I get rid of Kamak. So yeah. What else? What do we do? Yeah, I'm passing. I'm passing. I'm not. And Daniel wants some more support, so he gets. He wants Bester. Level the playing field on Bester. And Bester is. Oh. And he. Oh. Talia gets order above all. Which is kind of a nice warlord agenda. It's a major agenda, so. He needs to win by 10 to actually win this game, which will not happen. And the only problem is that this arrives too late and Inertia is already in the game, so it will give him plus one right now. Okay. What is there? Yeah, I'm passing, I suppose, and yeah, drop your barriers is being played on Lita, and she gets plus four. And I support the conflict with Elizabeth. She has five, so it means 10. I have 28. And then he's like, I just need that this not happen. That this doesn't happen. Okay. And, yeah. Is it 31? Oh my god. Bester gets into the game. So, and I boost Galen because I want him to be a stronger character. But he's not loyal. Oh, he's my character, so. Okay. Not thought three against my conflict, so 34, if I read it correctly. He still has Harriman, but he doesn't have any diplomacy. But, yeah. And, yeah, and he's looking into my cards with Sekor's intelligence, so. Yeah, we'll see. I mean, the mind games was really cool because he got one plus one through mind games. He rotated Earth, which is plus two, and he had further gains, plus three in one. Three, I mean, if you get three influence per turn, it's amazing. Dunar, ugh, an 11 cost, seven diplomacy. This is a huge character. He's strong. Yes, he is strong. And we'll go against this, so we'll see. Yeah, 41, I suppose. 41, yeah. 41 against. And I have what, 28 or 38? Okay, plus 10. 48. Oh, yeah. No. That's going to happen. 40 against 41. I think this actually will work out for me. This actually will work out somehow. And I will be plus one for me and for the psych horse. And we'll see how this goes out. So just get it over with. Okay, if I will have received, I'll go to 18 plus 2, which will give me 20, and I will win. Actually, this actually works out for me. This will work out for me. And I don't think they can do anything against it. I suppose this maybe the end. Or are we going one more turn? Or are we going? Oh, maybe we both have. I think we both have the same amount of influence. I would think we both are at 20 at the end, so nobody wins. And now they're talking about magic or something. And Daniel is thinking about what to do. Because he's not able to stop me, and he's just getting not enough from the rally the people. Even with Dunar in the game. And plus two for Kamak. Oh, plus no, yeah. Plus two for Kamak, who's opposing my conflict. I don't think it's enough. It's 44 against 48, I suppose. Or 43 against 48. Okay. Oh, no. What did he play? Oh, he's boosting. We totally forgot. Lead Alexander is actually inflatable, so you can. And yeah, I am playing 5 and 3 go down. So 40 again, 48 against 45 or something. But I don't think anybody else has much influence. So. Leader can be actually sponsor. I think you have to pay for every two influence for like half of the influence you pay. She gets stronger or she gets weaker in her psi rating. So psi ability. So right now I think I'm still winning. This config I'm winning. Nobody else really. I don't think has anything against it. Gonna help Lita. The Cyclops have zero, so they can't do anything. I have zero, I can't do anything. Oh no, it's 48 against 48. This is so bad. Oh, but I still have two characters in the game, so this is fine. Whew. And yeah. Plus 4, 52. I mean, if your conflicts are already at the beginning of the game, you were like 10 is enough or a lot, and now it's like 50 something. So yeah, if your conflicts reach those levels, you know you are in the end game. Or you can even have conflicts around 90 and stuff. We already had that. Yeah, Daniel is passing. Yeah, he's telling me he will do differently next turn. Okay, Daniel passes. What about the psych horse? Does he do anything? He still has Harriman. Oh. Oh shit, this is actually working out because I am not winning. Oh no. Oh, the highest ability. The highest ability supporting the conflict is 18 from Jeffrey. And I'm not winning the conflict by more than 18, so if he drops and discards be seeing you, I will not be able to claim any influence from the conflict, which will happen, I suppose. Oh no, this is, yeah, not good. Not good for me, and Daniel is happy about this. Level the playing field. Oh, and he is going against. And Harriman is going against. Oh, but he cannot. He cannot. He cannot because he's not part of the Narn. This should not be happening. He's not being. Yeah, now he's claiming it. There are only Narns who can participate in it. He played it, but he cannot take part. So yeah. So yeah, Mike. Yeah, now we are talking like to do it properly. If he played leveling the playing field on, he has to target a conflict. If he targeted rally the people.
Okay.
Such a, I'm just commenting this. This was such a great negotiation on trade talks. I mean. This was a huge endeavor of the of the free trade, like I don't know what was this, European Union and the US talking about TTPA, and Jeffrey Sinclair supporting a trade pact with the Earth planet and the Earth Alliance, but they didn't want it, so, and the Narns like hugely against it. So, yep, so bad. But now I have 17 plus 3, it's 20. I should be able to claim victory soon, but also could so Daniel, so the non-player. So we'll see. Come on. He has... He has 19. He has 19 now. If nothing happens, we both would have 20. So there is a Psycorps intelligence and another conflict, I think, in the game. Of course, the Narn player has a conflict, and I don't have any. Wow, I don't have any. Telepathic scan. Okay. Telepathic scan on the Narn player, and officer exchange. Nice. One of the nicest diplomacy conflicts. It doesn't cost you anything. It provides you with plus one, and if you. You know, if you butcher it up, if you fail, nothing happens. So I love those kind of conflicts are the best, you know. They're no high risk, and you still get plus one if nothing happens, if you're successful. You don't have to succeed by plus five or plus ten, you just have to succeed. So go just generally for these kind of conflicts. Officer exchange is one of the conflicts you can have three times in your deck easily. So, okay, Harriman is supporting telepathic scan. And I think 7 plus 2 and 9, I suppose. A friend of mine is just like, did you outward him? And I'm like, nope, I didn't. Or maybe I did, but be seeing you was played and the afterword discarded. Okay, officer exchange. Maybe I will go against that. Oh, they have. The non-player has already 17, by the way. So it was kind of cool. It's kind of high. 10 plus 7. plus 3, 20. So, okay, 9 against. Nine against, yes. Where? Here? Okay, Dunar, 7 plus, so it's 15. I think he has 15 now. 15 for... And Talia supports the Cyclops intelligence conflict. He just manages. I mean, playing Cyclops is kind of a solitaire game because nobody really has or plays characters with telepathic abilities. So it's kind of if you're playing Psy Conflicts, nobody can really, you know, do anything against them if they do not think about doing anything. Nathot is supporting the conflict, so another plus 3, I suppose. And I will not comment this. This laughter is nasty, but whatever. So, yeah, and somebody also played against the Officer of Change, I think. What was that? Talia? Yeah, maybe. Yeah, what am I doing? And now I think I will just kill him. I think now I got the idea of getting his minus 1. 5 against, okay. And now we have, I think, 15. Yep. 18 plus, 15 against. And there is still Jakar on the game. In the game, I mean, seriously, this will not be easy. I mean, another good thing about this game is that you don't really have any. Okay, Nakal. Okay, rather not not strong character. It's a plus 2 only in diplomacy, so. Johnny in the game. He may replace Jeffrey Sinclair, so I'm just playing him as another character. It costs 10. So you can easily play another, which is cool. We can easily play another another faction. You don't have to play John Sheridan as your ambassador, but you can easily play Jeffrey Sinclair, you can play Bester, you can play William Morgan Clark, and still play John Sheridan pushing towards presidency of the ISA within your faction, so it's kind of cool. Yeah. So I think he switched Kodat and got to 20, supporting the conflict, so we have 15 against, but I think we have enough cards to actually get against this, so... Let's kill him. Get Kamag out of the way. Come on, go. So, it's my turn now, and I'm thinking of what to do. I still have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and 8 marks. And the Cyclops player is like, what about... Oh, direct attack against Kamak. And Daniel is taking it back. And he still survives with, I think, one. Or how much? Yeah. I gave him 7. Ouch. Dust. Played on Jakar. Oh my god, an upgrade to Jakar is coming. This is very, I mean, I did not see this. This is not seen often, to be honest. And level the playing field played on, I think, Lita to be able to enter the officer exchange. And Susan is getting another. No, 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 not 8. Just no, no, no. I should not receive 8. 8 damage. I should receive only 1 damage because he has 8 and 7 damage, so only 1. But I don't really care right now because I think I'm winning this turn. So I'm like, I don't really. But another fault of mine, another mistake. Ugh, so bad. I mean, it doesn't matter because I still, Michael Garibaldi and Susan Ivanova are gone, even if as they are in supporting row and they will leave the game. And now, Jakar Enlightened. This is so hard to play, to be honest, because you really have to play Dust, and Dust is kind of expensive to play. And I didn't like this upgrade. Jakar's upgrade is so expensive. Also, the Forsaken is kind of hard to play, they just both do not provide him with such great abilities as other characters like Delenn. Going for Delenn transformed, she is pumped in Volon marks, she's pumped in Destiny marks. Now Jakar does not really get so much from being Enlightened or being Forsaken, so it's kind of a bummer, to be honest. Those cards should have been made better. And as Kamag is out of the way, Daniel lost 1 power, so okay, 30 against 26, so officer exchange is failing, so he will not receive any influence from that. What about the Cyclops? Do they do anything? Okay, no. Okay, nothing happens. I have 20. And he has 19, so yeah, I'm winning. But to be honest, I think we kind of made several mistakes. I think he should have 3 from revenge, so he should also be at 20, and we should have be at the same. And this was so bad. Oh, so the game comes to end. I have 20 power. Daniel has 19, but should have I think 22, and. Cyclops has 17 or 18, so kind of high too. So this was kind of a well balanced game, to be honest. I think we did several mistakes within the game which shouldn't have been done. It cost me several influence when I did that, and then I didn't recall about nowhere to hide for several rounds. Cost me a trade pack, I think, and stuff like that. So yeah, guys, be really, really careful about what you do, how you play. Count your abilities, count your influences well. Do not wait for things to happen, just be proactive, and we'll see each other next time. Bye.